here we are in downtown Winnipeg in the beautiful province of Manitoba. Spring is well and truly in the air, but maybe not in the mosquito capital of Canada. As they say over here, if the bugs don't get you in May, the bears will get you in July. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Archie McGlumpher MBE is in the house, where the atmosphere is pathetically quiet with not a bugger in the rink except the players, their massive egos and the drunk Zamboni driver. Leafs in white jerseys skating to my right, Jets in that gorgeous dark blue skating to your left, as we join things here in the first period. Winnipeg will have their captain Blake Wheeler back in the lineup tonight after leaving the game Wednesday with an undisclosed injury, but we all know it was about the collie wobbles. Will we finally see a Leafs power play goal tonight? As that is about as dry as my sense of humour. They'll have to find a way past that giant Winnipeg goalie, Connor Hellebuck. How about trying Zach Hyman on the power play tonight? He's doing just about everything else for this Leaf team. Can the Jets' recent signing Pierre-Luc Dubois get on track tonight and look remotely interested in playing? Probably not. Nothing much to report after a sleepy start to the first period, with the Jets carrying most of the play. Huge defenceman number 64 Logan Stanley, all 6'4" and 25 stone of him. He's very noticeable with his girth and his crushing hits. Reminds this reporter of fearsome Tam McPherson when he was the prop forward for the Kirkcudbury Select. He used to send the fear of God into the opposition and his own team, as he was both colourblind and mean-spirited. He once wiped out his own hooker and both flankers on a tragic day in Gala Shields, and is still banned to this day from attending church in Melrose for threatening the parish minister with a goose. Oh, both goalies very steady into the second period in a very even affair, with some solid defence from these two evenly matched sides. TJ Brodie and Zach Bogosian playing well for the Leafs, and big Logan Stanley, Tucker Pullman and Neil Pionk outstanding for Winnipeg for having tremendous hockey names. We're just over 5 minutes into the second, and it's the Leaf defenseman Travis Dermott with an innocent-looking shot from the point that sneaks past Connor. I'll blame my defenseman for that one. Hellebuck to open the scoring. Only the second goal of the season, but he'll take it. 1-0 Leafs. That lead wasn't to last for too long, as Andrew Kopp, with a wee dribbler, if you pardon the expression, ties things up on a bit of a defensive miscue, as a couple of Leafs go fishing for the puck and come up a few chips short of a fish supper. And it's all to play for again. No further scoring in the second, and a tight checking seesaw back and forth chess match of a game with no margin for error, and Archie could do with a wee tea break himself.
Oh, Daphne, she'll never get a man.
Oh, it was to be the Leafs with the upper hand at the start of the third, and Galchenyuk comes close to getting his first as a Leaf as he smashes the puck off the post after a nice wee feed from wee Willie Nylander. But the Leafs fail again on another thoroughly miserable power play, and it's the Jets with the momentum now with a bunch of grade A chances, all thwarted by Jack Campbell in net for the Leafs. Halfway through the third period, and as this next goal wins territory, the way these two netminders are playing, I would think so. Well, Archie was correct again in his predictions, as bugger all else happens, as both teams huff and puff and it's never enough, as that little bit of skill is missing, and we head to overtime. Just to rub salt into the wound, Winnipeg decides it's safer to give the Leafs another power play, knowing they'll never score on it, and predictably, the Leafs again prove how horrible their power play is as they fail again with a 4-on-3 advantage this time, where they would continue to pass the puck to themselves and the Winnipeg goalie with some rather uninventive play. This reporter hasn't seen such a woeful display with the extra man since Scotland couldn't score a single goal against Uruguay after Jose Bastardo was sent off in the 86 World Cup in the first minute. Half the Scottish squad looked like they were coked up to the eyeballs and they still couldn't score. Although they might have later that night in the bars outside Neha Stadium. So off to the shootout it is, and I must admit I had my thruppence on the men from Winnipeg with Man Mountain Hellebuck in net, but I shouldn't have underestimated Jack Campbell as he stymies all three Jets shooters, and the Leafs take 4 points from the last two games in Winnipeg as Jason Spezza patiently outwaits Hellebuck and scores the only goal, squeezing the puck just inside the post. Probably should have been given a delay a game penalty for taking so long to score. Well, both teams didn't exactly paint a Rembrandt out there tonight. More like a Bacardi-soaked losing bingo card from Polbeth Miners Club. A game where both teams provided plenty of sweat and labour but sorely lacked some composure in front of net, or could have maybe at least hit the target once or twice. Not for those that were hoping for a high-scoring encounter, but it was still a hard-fought defensive battle with stirring goaltending displays that would appeal to those that liked their hockey played in the trenches. Nevertheless, these two teams are both destined for the playoffs. Whenever that is, at this rate with all these COVID infections in the league, it'll probably be round about November. And with that, I'll ask you all to like and subscribe and press the wee bell for instant notifications, and it'll just make an old reporter happy. Archie McGlumpher MBE signing off and wishing there was a bar open, but alas, no. So I'm away to catch the last bus home. If I haven't missed it already, bloody overtime.